All right, we are back. I'm Steve Kimbrough here with Christina Hartlett.
Linhart.
Linhart. Linhart.
L-I-N-H-A-R-D-T.
And we are the Hollywood Boulevard podcast here at the Pig and Whistle. And I'm loving life. I'm so excited. The Pig and Whistle gave me a platform to do my little pod brother thing.
But it's great because it's so, as we were talking earlier, it's so iconic Hollywood.
You know, there isn't anybody that I said, oh, I'm at the Pig and Whistle, they all know.
Of course, yeah, yeah. It's a landmark.
They know like what it is, they know where it is, and they're kind of impressed. They're like, you're doing your podcast at the Pig and Whistle? It's like, right. Yeah, I am.
It's a historical institution, and it's sort of legendary. It carries on that golden era of Hollywood.
And the food is amazing. It's awesome. And they gave me the hookup, too. So if you come in and say you know the Pod Brother, they give you like $3 drafts and a 15% discount on your food. 15% discount on your food.
I didn't know that.
And the open bus tour, if you mention the Pod Brother, you get buy one, get one free.
Wow, I didn't know that. I'd be drinking beers this whole time. No.
And that tour, I think it's $30 for kids and $50 for adults. So, you know, you buy one, get one free. That's a pretty good deal.
That is. So all your friends out there in the Midwest who are watching the Pod Brother, you come out here, you have your meal at the Pig and Whistle, you feel like you're part of Hollywood.
Drop my name, drop the Pod Brother, and you got the hookup.
You got the golden ticket to Hollywood.
So. That's how we get down. I feel most privileged because you're on my podcast.
Aw, thank you.
Because I really admire you. I think you're an amazing talent and a wonderful person.
You.
I see you work, and you're very passionate about what you do.
Thank you so much.
And you pull and push energy into those seniors, and that's not an easy thing to do.
Thank you. It is true.
Not easy.
It is true. Sometimes I'm like, wow. But yeah. But yeah, I so genuinely want to. I so genuinely want them to have an experience because I'm there. I feel like I have to do my best.
And see, I have no, you know, I have no professional training in any kind of therapy. I'm a stand-up comedian who does, you know, a podcast, and you know, I write film scripts, and you know, I make short comedy films. So. You know, the program that I'm doing with them is more like, you know, singing karaoke, and we do like the script writing, you know, workshop.
But it's great, the karaoke, because I would walk in and I'd hear you and I'd hear then the ladies singing, or I'd hear all of a sudden like this great old voice coming out and somebody in a wheelchair just perked up and started singing with you. I love the karaoke that you do with them.
It's fun. I love karaoke.
And it really stimulates them because, you know, as you know, some of our clients, they, you know, have lost the capacity sometimes to speak or to remember words, but it's in there. And when they sing, they can still remember the words.
Yeah.
And that there was that whole documentary about that and research about that music stimulates the entire brain. And so it's a lot easier for people to communicate then. So the importance of music.
I saw a documentary about Glenn Campbell, who had like some serious dementia, but could go on and do an entire show, singing and playing, remembering the chords and remembering the song. But as soon as the song's over, he's like looking at the band like, who are you guys?
Right, that was a powerful documentary. I saw that too.
I know you?
Right. Right. It was really, I mean, it was fascinating, but it was great that, because, you know, people know when they first have the onset of Alzheimer's, and he did, and he gave permission to have this documentary made as he declined. Mm-hmm. And the family did too, and I think that was very valuable that they allowed that. It was very heartfelt, but it was also very important, I think.
Well, it created awareness
about
the, I guess, illness. If it's an illness, I think it's would be considered an illness. But it put it on the radar, you know, because you had a celebrity going through it, and you got to actually, you know, kind of sit back and watch this film with this story of this iconic country singer going through dementia, and it was amazing.
It really was, and it also, because what I thought was interesting is that it went through the phases and talked about what you just said, that he could sing, and then he turns around, who are you? Where am I? You know? But that's important for us to develop work with Alzheimer's people, to keep stimulating them to see that, yes, people can still totally function here and can't function here.
Mm-hmm.
And to find out so that you can keep stimulating. Because so often, I'm sure you have this all the time, is with some of our patients, all of a sudden they'll start talking about something that we can't believe how cognitive they are.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a shift into lack of cognition. And so I think that documentary really helped also to see the different stages, and so that we can help people.
And your program is called the Imagination Workshop.
Imagination.
That's a good title for it, because they do have an imagination. They may not remember your name or who you are, but they still have an imagination.
Right. And in the moment, you can show them a picture, like something like a Thomas Kincaid type picture of a cottage. And, well, what does this make you think of? And sometimes we get a story from them.
And I like, I mean, there's one of the residents who I think is just adorable. Her imagination is, oh, I just got back from church and I'm going to go upstairs and make you some cocktails. So if you want to go downstairs and rack up the pool table and we'll come down and we'll have some drinks and we'll talk about what we did like at the mall yesterday. I'm like,
what?
We got drinks, shooting pool, we making cocktails, we went to the mall yesterday, and then when we're all done, we're going up to like the gondola and we're going to have some champagne. You know, it's like, that's all in one sentence, you know?
Right,
and I'm like,
right.
That's like, you see that? I'm like, yeah, I'll be ready. I'll be downstairs shooting pool. Come and get me when you're ready.
Right, and that's a great place to be in, because, you know, at least that's her reality. She's reliving a lot of the fun stuff, you know, versus... Once we had a client who was in constant anxiety, and no matter how, because she was somewhere living a time in her life that was so anxiety ridden. Mm-hmm. And so it's wonderful to see a lot of our clients who are there like, how was your week? Oh, I went home. I flew back to Willingboro, New Jersey. Great. You had a great vacation. That's great.
Yeah, my parents and I, we went to, it's like, wait a minute, aren't you 90? And your parents had you in their 30s. That means they would be like 140 years old.
And they look great, you know.
It's almost like, you know, you don't want to be like, your parents are dead, and kill that bubble or kill the thing. Or, you know, I know some people might have a tendency to be like, you know, no, that's not happening. You're here. They're like a constant reality check on them versus just... flowing with that imagination.
Right, and there are schools of thought about that, is should you try to get them back to reality or not. And I personally think if it's a space that they're in that they're happy, you keep going with that. It's kind of like the rules of improvisation, mm-hmm. is that you never negate. Okay, now we're on the veranda in Switzerland. Yes, we're on the veranda in Switzerland.
I have a pretty good rule on that. If whatever you are imagining isn't hurting anybody, then we can roll with that.
Exactly.
We can go with that. But if you are, you know, turning the stove on and forgetting you got the stove on and you can burn the place down, then, you know, that's where I would step in and bring you back into reality. You know,
you know,
don't touch the stove. You're not a stove person.
Right.
The stove is off limits, and this is, you know, not cool.
Right. And I think that's why family members of people who are going through this are very concerned, and they become very, usually the child becomes the parent and is very concerned, and so does keep trying to get them back to reality for their own safety. And yeah, definitely when safety is involved, try to get reality in there or just somehow intervene or redirect.
Speaking of safety and what's real and what's not, what's your take on Trump these days?
I mean, I really thought...
Is he going through dementia, or is he really, you know, I think he knows what he's doing.
Yeah,
I don't think he's crazy. I think he's, you know, I think he's like Weird Al Yankovic, where the joke is on us.
I think so too.
He's really, you know, brilliant and smart, and he wants to make a Donald Trump global brand, and he's doing it. And I don't think he really cares if he wins or not.
No, he's getting what he wants. He's getting all the attention he could possibly want. I originally really thought that this was like a parody, and even on Prairie Home Companion, the joke was always that Bill Clinton and he made a little bet, like, let's do that, because I always feel he's just delivering the presidency to Hillary on a silver platter with the way he behaves. And I thought he just did this to blow apart the Republican Party, which I'm fine with, because the current Republican Party needed a shift.
Yeah,
now there
needed an overhaul.
Very much so. Now, you know,
I mean, our whole political system needs an overhaul, but let's start with the Republicans.
Right.
And, like, you know, dovetail it out to the rest of the, you know, departments.
Right, because originally the Republican Party, you know, the Republican Party of my grandfather's day, I still didn't quite believe in it, but, you know, it was about, you know, small government and people taking care of themselves. But now the Republican Party has really been about taking away people's rights. That's a good friend of mine who's a judge. He was a courtroom judge, a Superior Court judge. He was Republican, and he stopped during the Bush years because he said, and he saw the Supreme Court, he said the Supreme Court is to protect people's rights, not take them away, because he saw them being taken away with, you know, trying to make abortion illegal, with, you know, marriage equality, all that. And so that party needs a shift. Everything needs a shift, but that party really needed a shift. So at first, I supported Trump only in that, not as a candidate, but I was like, great, blow apart the party and just deliver it to whoever the Democratic candidate will be. Now I'm getting a little concerned that this many people still take him seriously. I mean, I don't think there's any way he could win, but I am a little concerned. And just in the eyes of the rest of the world, because I have friends over in Switzerland and Germany emailing me and saying, we're shaking in our boots. What's going on here? Could this guy really be president? Because we'll all be gone, done, over.
Yeah. Well, I think it's, you know, there's a lot of people in this country who have been aware of the subsurface conspiracy with that Trump-like idealism,
yeah.
And this is bubbling that to the surface.
Yeah.
So, like, the people who are going, like, no, there are people who are out to use our systems to oppress and to eliminate and to segregate and to departmentalize. They do exist, and they are in positions of power. Like, this isn't my imagination. Like, I'm not being hypersensitive or hyper black or being like, you know, get over it. Like, no, there are some, they exist.
Yeah,
there's true. Some real people and real groups of people who are like really trying to muck it up for other people,
right?
And you know, the phoenix out of the ashes with this whole kind of Trump thing, it to me is that.
Mm-hmm.
It's like it's bubbling up all of that subsurface groups of people who use their power and influence and their money and their authority to insert systemic systems to keep people oppressed.
Right. You know, it's interesting because, and also then when you think about the type of people who vote for these people who don't have the money or the power but will still vote against their own best interests. And you know, people would often talk to me about my being German, about, oh, the Nazis. And I said, you know, in modern day Germany and the U.S., there is a small group of punk Nazis in Germany still. But there are huge hate groups in this country. Way more neo-Nazis in the United States all over. I just got a map of all the different hate groups. So, you know, we go around thinking that society is reasonable, but there's so many people who aren't. And then there was a magician I worked with that on Magic Mondays last Monday, and he put it well, like that, you know, you look at a lot of people who are working class who maybe never really paid attention to politics who are supporting Trump. And somehow he described that it made sense because they don't know really how politics works. And they just see somebody who is going to shift for them, they think. And then somebody else talked about how people need authority. They're so scared of the other. Those people coming in here and hurting us. They want somebody who's going to say, I'm going to put up a wall or something. You know, mm-hmm. Without a kind of reality check, they just need this extremist security.
Well, it's that fear. You
yes.
know, if you can get in there and plant the smallest seed of fear, it mm-hmm. grows infectiously, rapidly. And next thing you know, you're like hunkered in your closet with tinfoil on the walls. It's like, oh my God, if anybody goes through that door that is not look and sound exactly like I do, I'm going to blow their head off with this 12 gauge to exercise my Second Amendment. It's like the fear has gotten so many people mentally and emotionally and even physically and politically paralyzed to yes. where it allows someone like a Donald Trump and a Cruz and to completely and totally manipulate them.
Right.
You know,
good.
I mean,
yeah.
When Giuliani got on stage and just completely went like a psycho man with the whole fear thing, it was like a joke. It was like, it can't be serious.
Right, but people are, and I noticed this because, you know, I've lived in so many different countries, like in Europe and in Africa and here. And Americans are very, very fear-based, a lot of Americans, more so than I've seen in Europe and Africa. And I try to analyze that because in a lot of these countries are war-torn or have experienced war recently, not in Western Europe, but a lot of people still remember World War II. There's still generations. My father was, you know, a child when Dresden was bombed. And I see so much more fear here, and I think what a lot of it is is that we're more isolated here. Kids grew up as latchkey kids. You know, their parents were working. People are isolated in their basement. They're watching these videos that are conspiracy theories. Whereas in Europe, at night, everybody's walking around the town center. And you're talking to people. You're meeting people. You're hanging out with people you don't know. And they're like your best friend. In Africa, the parts of Africa I lived in were very impoverished. But there was a tribal community and tribal life. And so people just knew people. And you trusted your neighbor. But here, a lot of people don't know their neighbors. And then it's this isolation that I think is creating the fear. And then this messaging of...
That's true. And I also find it a little bit... it's like ironic. You have the pride that you are the best people, right, the best nation, the best country, the best this, the best that. Then what the hell are you afraid of?
Right, exactly. That's the funny thing.
That's like, to me, I don't get that. It's like,
I know. I was like, what? I don't get it.
Wait a minute. You know, every American thinks that they are the best of, you know, the planet on everything in every category.
Right, right. So what? Right.
And even in the categories they're not, they're like, we don't really have to be the best in that category because we're the best in so many other categories, it cancels out that category. So
right. I know.
Forget you. It's like, you know, the arrogance. Like, if you got that kind of balls.
Right. Then what are you worried about?
What are you afraid of?
Right, because people talk about our military, and it is one of the most, or the most powerful in the world. So what are you worried about?
Yeah, like our military could end today.
Mm-hmm.
We still would have the baddest military on the planet.
Right.
Because if anything went down, there's probably 30 million people would sign up tomorrow.
Right,
just
exactly.
Like Pearl Harbor.
Exactly, that's right. That's
you know, right. So even if we, just the fact that we have a government in place that can, like, you know, make a military happen in a nanosecond. And we already have the technology and the warfare, like, gadgets.
Mm-hmm.
What, even if the military closed tomorrow,
right,
here's the key, lock it up. You know, we got our weapons here, bullets there. We got our Kevlar, you know, and our tanks and our jets and planes. If anybody try anything, we're so secure,
right,
and confident that we could fire it up again tomorrow.
Right.
With about 30 million people.
It's so true. And with what we have in technology and weapons and defense. Yeah.
It's like, so we,
why are you all worried about?
We need to relax. We need to be like, you need to take a chill pill.
Right. And pre-9/11, with all the wars, with World War I, World War II, Vietnam, Korea, everything that we were involved in, nothing ever happened on our soil. Nobody ever invaded the United States. Nobody ever. We did have that horrific terrorist attack of 9/11, but other than that, we haven't been invaded, and or we haven't had any kind of warfare on our soil in the 20th century or 21st century. What other country can say that?
I know, and I think the Second Amendment has a lot to do with that, with citizens having the right to bear arms, because, you know, I think I've heard a couple places where there have been some leaders that say you'd be crazy to invade America because just there's so many civilians with weapons.
Right,
before
right.
The military can even get there, you're going to have some serious resistance.
Right, so these guys have these stockpiled weapons and everything. What are they so paranoid about? They're going to come take my guns.
Get my guns. I'm going to shoot somebody. So, all right. I just wanted to kind of get your update on the Trump thing,
right,
because it's hard, you know, it's the white elephant in the room of America right now, even though, you know, no one wants to talk about him anymore or give him the satisfaction or that much exposure. But we're at the point now to where the dialogue needs to continue, just so that we can, you know, recognize that there are still some rational, intelligent, right, Americans.
Right. And I think there will be, only because when I saw Obama beat out McCain, and McCain was a real politician, and I have respect for McCain. He was a war hero. He was a real politician. I didn't agree with his policies, but I respect that man for what his service. And Obama still won by a landslide, so I do think there is sanity. And then Obama won over Mitt Romney at a time when people weren't happy because Obama couldn't clean up Bush's mess fast enough because Congress didn't let him. So people were unhappy. And Mitt Romney, you know, again, a career politician. I didn't agree with his policies. I don't think it would have been a good idea for him to be president, but he was a good man. He was a decent man, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And still Obama won. So I do think that that intelligence will win out, I hope. But what was interesting is this little video I saw about analyzing the psychology behind people who support Trump and you know, they're authoritarians. They want an authority figure. They said, it's not Trump. There will be more. There will, if it's not Trump, there will be other figures like this that these people flock to. And that's the scary thing.
Yeah. And here's the other thing. You know, the people who are kind of laying low, who were probably afraid to be as bold as Donald has
right.
been to preserve their political career, now
they've been permission. All, you know, all bets
permission.
Are off, yeah.
Like, no matter what they do, is going to be 1,000 times milder than Trump.
Exactly, exactly.
You know, whoever comes up with any, like, Republican radical ideas about running, you know, will probably be like, well, at least he's not Trump.
Right, which is scary, because even those of us who were, I mean, I was very against Dick Cheney's policies and what he did. And even I'm quoting Dick Cheney saying he says that you can't vote for Trump. So, you know, even I, you know, I mean, I even I'm, it's scary because he's pushed it so extreme that the unacceptable is acceptable.
Well, the phoenix out of the ashes, I think, is if the government takes it serious to reform our electoral process, this will never ever happen again.
Let's hope. Yes. Yes.
You know, if they can figure out how to be like, okay, all contributions go into one pool and then that's it. And then the people who qualify to run for a position gets to split that money evenly.
Right.
And then we're only going to focus on the issues.
Right.
Because we're going to have a subcommittee do the vetting, so that there's no surprises about
right.
this or that. And it's like, we know that, we vetted it, we had a subcommittee evaluate it, so now we're okay to move on.
Right.
And put this as a person that has, you know, a past or an experience, but they still qualify to run for presidency, and this is not going to be the issue for whether you're qualified to run the country or not.
Right, exactly.
And if we can put something like that into place,
yes, I agree.
Then no Donald Trumps will ever get a chance to even be qualified, because that process is going to qualify, you know, really smart, wise people and squash a lot of the politics and the muckraking and the shit flinging and all that
right.
stuff.
I know, the behavior that is so childish. I can't believe anyone takes people seriously who talk like 8-year-old boys.
I can, because I've, you know, as a comedian touring this country, and I've
right.
been to every state, and trust me, I have looked out in front of hundreds of people, and I'm like, wow, I have to, like, dumb my act down to, like, shadow
right.
puppets.
I've heard that from stand-up comics who tour. That's right. I've heard
and
that from another stand-up comic.
It's
yeah.
like you're doing some, you know, some intellectual, political, social, and they are looking at you like a deer in headlights.
Right.
And then it's like you do like a fart joke and they're like, pull my finger. And I'm like, oh my God, this guy's hysterical.
Right. I know. Yeah. It's really scary. And when America talks about being the best and everything, well, what about education?
Yeah.
Let's go back to education.
But, you know, a lot of people in the Republican Party are afraid of smart people.
Right. Because
they
takes
got
away their
into
power.
Office from people who are incredibly ignorant so
right.
that they can get into office and do what they need to do.
Right.
Without anybody challenging it whatsoever.
Right, because the nation, I mean, the nature of this nation, that we do have the capability of being all equal. It's not necessarily there, but it's set up by law that if people are more intelligent, then they will rise up and they will lose their power, and those people will lose
yeah.
their power. So keep people dumb, because in this system, you can. If you have intelligence, you can go somewhere.
But that's what I like about the internet. The internet has allowed, you know, information to sink
right.
into people that wasn't there before.
Right. And that,
go ahead.
I was going to say that that's excellent. Flip side of what I'm seeing is that people get all these documentaries that are complete conspiracy theory, or they just keep getting something that keeps pointing their view out, you know, and it may be false. So people got a lot of false information. Like, there was a lot of false information about Hillary Clinton out there.
Mm-hmm.
Tons. But you say it loud enough and enough times, and it's there. That being said, still, it's invaluable that we have the internet, because Hitler would not have been able to rise to power if we had the internet.
No way.
Because even like Xeroxing leaflets or pamphlets, you couldn't do. You couldn't hold meetings. So, yeah. So it does keep from having that kind of dictatorship.
Yeah. So let's put that to bed for now. We did our quota of political chatter. Let's talk about your video, this video that we are going to see. And
stop for a second.
Yeah.
Okay, now it's back.
And it, pause it for us so we don't miss anything. There you go. And enlarge. Okay. So, where am I here? Oh, forgot. There we go. So, tell us about this video we're about to see.
So yes, this is Angels of Venice, which was a group started by harpist Carol Tatum. And for several years, while Carol Tatum was here, still here in Los Angeles, I was the lead singer of Angels of Venice. She started the ensemble as harp, cello, flute, and then we started doing medieval music together. And Angels of Venice had several albums out with Windham Hill. And so it's very sort of crossover. We did medieval music, but it had a new age touch. And so yeah, it's Angels of Venice, and this is Douce Dame Jolie.
Awesome. All right, so let's take a look at it, and then we'll talk about it. Well, that's awesome. Very nice. Very cool.
Thank you.
You have a beautiful voice.
Thank you.
You know, I binge watch all of those medieval like series, like the Tudors and Rain and the Borgias and all that stuff.
Oh,
and
great!
So I can really appreciate medieval music.
Oh, thank you. Oh, great!
And you have a little bit of a Celtic background as well as being German, or
some Scottish, yes. And yeah. I do a lot of Celtic music. Of course, I've done a lot of German music. And singing here in town for the German consulate. Oops, I didn't stop it. do a lot of German music here, representing the city of Berlin here in Los Angeles. But yes, I just recently did a concert of Celtic music. Since Angels of Venice left town, I started a group called the Celtic Consort of Hollywood, and we just played up at the Brand Library at the Plaza concert series. And yeah, the Celtic music and the early Baroque, that really speaks to me. So yes, Scottish.
Well, I am a Cunningham, and I do sport the Cunningham kilt every once in a while. Actually,
that's right. You were going to be in our music video.
Yeah, it's a black kilt with a Cunningham tartan tie and socks.
Oh, I bet you look good in that.
Yeah, I have fun with it.
Yeah. Oh, you have to come to the Celtic Arts Center or something.
I would love to do that. I'd love to come when you're performing or you're doing something cool.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It was just last Friday, the 29th of July, was when we had the concert. Actually, it was the night before I first was on the podcast, so 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
I'll send you some videos from that for later.
So, Are you composing and writing as well as performing, or you just basically perform, you pick pieces that you like in different shows, or are you, composing and writing some lyrics or, some things yourself?
Right, well, it depends on the job. So, believe it or not, a lot of the German stuff and the Celtic stuff is really work for hire. Mm-hmm. A concert series hired me to do it, so. But I did produce two solo albums, Circus Sanctuary and Voodoo Princess. And we watched the Circus Sanctuary mm-hmm. video, the Habanera with Ron Jeremy.
Yeah.
And for those, what I did was I rearranged. I took public domain tunes, old arias, old Renaissance, medieval, and then we rearranged it and made up jazz or salsa or different styles and had a band, a rock band, and I rewrote the lyrics. So I rearrange and I write lyrics, but I don't really compose. Like, I'm not really a singer-songwriter.
Okay. Well, that's cool. I mean, I look at your work and you have the potential the magnetism of being, someone who composes or creates. Like, okay, I wonder if she makes her own stuff, because that's, something I would probably want to check out.
Thank you. Well, I mean, the albums are very original. I mean, a lot of people barely recognize the tunes, so they're rearranged. So my albums, Circus Sanctuary and Voodoo Princess, are the most original. Like, that's really my original thing. But then otherwise, it's really just reinterpreting what already exists in my own style. Like, when I was in music history class at USC, I would listen to pieces, and I said, I can envision this, but with a juggler here or an aerialist there.
Do you do, any acrobatic stuff or any aerial? I know you had mentioned, clown stuff. You were, a naked clown once, or,
Yes. There are a few videos up there, but I work with Tuba Heatherton, the clown. He's a Ringling Brother clown. And we've done a lot of acts where he's flipping me around. He's actually a very, very strong clown, and he'll flip me around while I'm singing and that sort of stuff. But I don't do the amazing aerial work that Cirque du Soleil artists do. I worked with a circus of... It was a watered-down circus with people from Cirque du Soleil, and we went to Guantanamo Bay, Cuba. And I've worked with a lot of Cirque du Soleil aerialists, but I'm usually on the ground singing, and they're doing what they're doing up there.
What do you think about the, we can fly to Cuba now, and Obama opening up embassies, and we can jump back and forth. What's your take on having access to Cuba after 60-something years?
Right. I'd love to be able to go soon. I mean, I could go. A lot of my neighbors have been going, and I'd like to go while it's still Cuba, because it's not like when East Germany opened up and immediately West Germany connected with it, and it was, you didn't feel East Germany at all much. I've been told with Cuba, it's going to take a while for it before it gets too commercialized. Mm-hmm. So I'd like to go now because now would be like what Cuba is.
Yeah.
So a lot of my neighbors have been going. They've been showing me pictures. And also, I remember because my grandparents, that was where they went on their honeymoon. Because back then, that was before pre-Castro. Mm-hmm. It was the playpen of the rich
in
Florida.
Yeah, it was the cool place to go.
Yeah, and so it was very decadent. Very elegant. So, I would like to go soon. And in Guantanamo, even though it's on the island of Cuba, none of the Cuban flair. None of it. Guantanamo is like 1950s America, like a Twilight Zone version of 1950s America. There's zero, because it's still considered U.S. soil because we put a base there.
Wow, because I want to go. I know JetBlue is going to start flying there in September. And they're doing like, I think it's $199 round trip or something.
Oh, wow, that's good.
Some kind of special deal. So I just want to jump on and get over there, maybe do a couple of little podcast things and just, you know, come back. You know?
Well, let me know if you go. I'll go down there.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, $200 for like, whatever.
Yeah, $200, man. I'm sure it's going to go up, but it's like a promotional thing. But
Yeah, because for a while you could only go if you were doing something artistic or went on one of these artistic tours. But if JetBlue is doing that. But you know that their weights, like all my neighbors have been doing that, and they just went on some sort of tour where they take you and they show you certain. It's an arts connection tour, which is great. I'd love to do that anyway. So, I mean, I would have been able to go even when it was closed because I could have gone on my German passport. But I'd like to go and soon, within the next few years before it redevelops.
Well, I know a couple of people went once they got out of the country. So, like, if you went out of the country, then you could go to Cuba, but then go to Cuba back. To Europe or another country, and then back to Europe. You couldn't do a U.S. to Cuba or a Cuba to U.S.
Right, exactly.
But you could go, like, you know, out and in.
Right, but you had to make sure, like, you didn't get a stamp or something because technically they could question you at the border or the flight, but how often does someone sit there and look and say, oh, you have the stamp from Cuba, not you, you know, so, but, yeah.
You know, when I lived in New York, I did have a Cuban friend who flew these twin-engine planes, like, under the radar and smuggled cigars in and out of Cuba.
Oh, wow.
And one day he asked me if I would go with him. And I was really tempted to, but I was, like, afraid that, you know, it'd be my luck. The plane goes down and, you know, and I'm the guy that, like, gets thrown in a Cuban jail for 100 years. And
or, for, yeah, down there, or for whatever reason you get stopped at either immigration and they find your loot on you. Yeah, that kind of thing is just not worth it. Like, a guy I knew, he was a circus guy, and he was a little down and out, so he took a job smuggling Mexicans over the border. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. You know, it's just illegal. The first run, he gets caught, and boom, in jail.
Wow. You know? U.S. side, Mexican side?
U.S. side, fortunately. At least he was on the U.S. side. He was an American citizen. And he was bringing illegal workers over to Mexico. And, you know, for me, ethically, there's nothing wrong with that, but it is illegal. When something's illegal and it's big stakes, I always try to stay away just because what if you're that one?
It's not worth the risk.
Exactly. There are other things to do in life. And I have no moral judgment whatsoever. Great, you know, sell the cigars. But just for your own safety, it's like, well, why?
You know, what keeps me out of trouble and has kept me out of trouble is I have to enjoy what I'm doing.
Yeah, right.
If I can't enjoy it, I don't do it. And if, you know, anxiety and, you know, the fear of dying or going to jail or losing your life is no fun for me. That's not fun.
Right.
Like, it cancels out the money, the drug, the joy, the women. It's like that anxiety cancels out the fun and it's dead. It's dead. No, it's dead, dead, dead. I can't do it.
Well, that's good because that means, because there's all kinds of addictions in this world, and a lot of people are adrenaline junkies or risk addicts. And so for them, it isn't even about the end product of the money, the girls, the drugs, but the actual risk of what if I get caught. And people are hooked on that.
But there's a lot of ways to get that same adrenaline without doing something illegal.
I agree, yeah.
You know, and you know, I've been able to do things like that.
Right. Performing, you know. Jumping out of planes.
Yeah.
Nature sports, all kinds of things. Yeah.
Naked karaoke.
Wow.
That is very risky and scary.
That doesn't bother me at all because I grew up in Europe naked. Like, I'll get naked at the drop of a hat. Okay.
Nice. Well, you know, I'll have to call you for my first naked party.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you can come and do some naked karaoke with me and my friends.
Or we could set up, like, we could do some sort of cultural exchange in Cuba. Maybe we get a naked karaoke show over there or something.
I'm down. I'll host it. Okay. And you can sing in it.
But seriously, I don't know how, but if you go to Cuba, if I'm around.
It's on my radar.
We should try to do a show.
It's on my
there.
Bucket list. I want to bring the Pod Brother to Cuba and just interview some locals and interview, you know, some diplomats at the American embassy and, like, you know, some musicians and some, you know, some chefs, you know, or even just like little corner, you know, coffee shops.
Yeah, the people.
Just the people. Like, get.
Yeah,
you know.
Absolutely.
And the cars are from the 50s. So, like, the newest car is like a 1959 Buick or whatever. So, like, the mechanic. I'm very, like, I would love to go into, like, a mechanic shop and just, like, they got three tools because that's all they need. You know, you just a wrench, a ratchet, screwdriver, and a hammer, and you could fix any 1950s, any car.
And some duct tape.
And some duct tape.
Tape together.
So, you know, I would really like to,
before
it gets too commercialized.
Right.
But, you know, get there in that window where it's still kind of raw.
Right. Exactly. You know? That's what I mean, too. Like, and I know it's going to be raw for a while because even though it's open, it's still not open for, like, Hiltons and Hyatts and Sheratons to just go in.
Yeah. There's not going to be a Jiffy Lube on every corner
right.
6 months from now.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. So there is still time. But eventually there will be. Eventually there will be. It's no question. Like when I was on Guantanamo Bay, I couldn't believe, you still had your Starbucks and your Subway. Or like McDonald's in Moscow, you know?
Yeah. Like America, is like every intersection is called Generica because there's like there's a McDonald's, a Burger King, a Walgreens, a
Starbucks.
Yeah, Starbucks. And you could be like, you know, plop down in the middle of it and you have no idea what state or city you're in.
Right, exactly.
Because it's, you know, to our credit, you know, our infrastructure is so evolved to where we have Generica intersections.
Right.
And that's when you travel, you have no idea how awesome that is.
Yeah, that's true. Because
no idea.
It's true.
Because, you know, you could go for days and not see anything in so many places on the planet. In America, you're about 4 hours away from any intersection that has things you need.
Right. That is true. The convenience and what we have and the comfort.
You could throw a dart blindfolded at America and you're 4 hours away from a Generica intersection.
Right. It's true.
And you can get your Burger King, your Big Mac, your Starbucks latte with soy milk.
Yeah, that's the only thing I drink is like green tea lattes. Otherwise, I don't eat Burger King. That's why, like, I walk around. I'm like, there's nothing to eat. I don't eat meat. And I don't eat muffin. I don't eat cheese. But
you're a unique person.
I had this hybrid upbringing of like back and forth between here and Europe, and I don't think I quite felt at home anywhere.
You got the best of both worlds. I mean, because you know you've got the kind of the European flavor and fundamentals, but also the American, you know. You know what Americans have to offer as far as amenities in your upbringing.
Even with the lack of justice in America, still, I would say our justice system is one of the best. Because I've had problems in other countries, and you know here in America, you know everyone knows the legal system is really functioning. Lawyers get paid a lot of money, and you know I'm not a litigious person, but I'm saying you know like I had an accident in Bali that was the hotel's fault. There was nothing I could do. Nothing. Yeah. You know, I got injured. There was nothing I could do. Whereas that if that happened in a hotel in the United States, things would be taken care of. And, you know, when I got abandoned in Senegal because I went on a dance tour and the guy left. And, I mean, I had the time of my life, so it wasn't any problem. But, you know, there was no repercussion. So I will say that. And I love Europe, and I think it's so beautiful. But I choose to live here. I could live in Germany, but I like to travel there, but I like to live here, so that there's a certain kind of, I guess, a certain kind of comfort.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe we're just
decadent.
That's
kind of the same
thing
that happened to me in Cannes, you know, so, like they broke into my flat and stole all of my cameras and my clothes.
Oh,
and
no.
And they hit me hard. I mean, everything, you know, a laptop, camera, phone, money, you know, my passport was in the backyard along with my driver's license. So, you know, they emptied out my credit cards and my cash, but they left at least my passport and driver's license.
At least they were decent so you could get out of the country. You had an ID, but oh my God, that's crazy.
And so I went to I went to the Cannes police and said, you know, what are you guys going to do about it? And they just looked at me like, nothing.
Wow. Yeah.
We're not going to do anything about it.
Yeah, yeah.
I go, well, can we like fill out a report or something? Like, you know, so if at least if there's a, you know, you know, reports of an incident like this, you can have some place to start when, and they stop because it was happening. So it's like open season on filmmakers in Cannes.
Right. Oh, wow. So that's just what happens, the risk you take or whatever.
Out of 10 people get ripped off. So it's to the point to where it's not even worth filling out papers on it. It's just like a pandemic that you can't even
do anything.
It's just like, look, you know, hey.
Wow.
Don't bring any money, credit cards, jewelry, to Cannes. Just don't bring anything of value. Just come to Cannes with a passport and some boxer shorts, and that's it.
Right. That's good to know. That's actually good to know if I ever go to Cannes. But
yeah,
for the most part, when I travel, although Germany and Switzerland are really quite safe, and I go there a lot, but still, I you know, I don't bring any good jewelry. I don't, you know, I don't bring a lot of cash. I try to go by credit card or even traveler's checks. That's what I did in Africa, was traveler's checks, although I never got robbed in Africa.
It was safe. It just, your stuff wasn't safe.
Right. That's what I mean. Yeah. So I just don't bring anything too valuable when I travel. I try not to.
Yeah. Because there were, I mean, I noticed a lot of like single girls walking from parties late night holding their shoes, and they didn't really feel threatened or, you know, there wasn't, you didn't hear about like girls getting jumped in at night post parties or anything, but you did hear everybody got ripped off.
Right, theft. Yeah, that's
every day you were hearing somebody's like ripoff story.
Wow. Yeah, exactly. And that's kind of what happened when I was in Senegal. I lived in Senegal and Southern Africa. Well, Southern Africa is dangerous, but Senegal, I never worried about bodily harm, but you know, people would want to rip you off or, you know, con you or scam you. But I remember I would just go, like, it was just sort of my look back then. But I remember I was in South Africa and I met these Kenyan guys and they were talking to me. And after we became friends, they said, we thought, look at that girl. She's so lovely, but she's so poor. Because I was wearing my like a blazer jacket. It was my grandfather's blazer jacket and combat boots. But that was like my style. But they thought I was just like dirt poor that I had to wear my grandfather's coat.
Because you had no money to buy your own girl shoes.
So to just dress like a hippie when you're traveling and you're fine.
That's funny. So let's get personal. You have a boyfriend?
I do.
How long you been dating?
We've been dating for only 9 months now.
It's new.
It's quite fresh. It's quite fresh, but this is, you know, definitely the first person I've dated that I said, yes, this can be long term.
Oh, that's cool.
And it's funny. This is sort of a lesson for everybody, you know, because we're always looking for something, right? And we look all over the world. But then I was looking for someone who was appropriate, because I'm never really dating age-appropriate men a lot older than me, and I realized that it really just doesn't work. My friends are a lot older, and that's great. But in relationships, I think people need to be a little closer in age. And then I did a lot of internal work and a lot of internal processes. And there he was in my building. He also owns a condo in the same unit I own a condo. And he'd been there 8 years before me, and I've been there 8 years. So, or he'd been there like 5 years before me. So he was right there on the second floor. So, but it was, I think, I was trying to tell a friend of mine who felt he wasn't going to find somebody. He just had a breakup and didn't think he was going to find somebody. And I said, you know, he's like, where do you find people? And yes, LA is a hard dating town.
It's very hard.
Because people are here for an ulterior motive or here just like to get somewhere, and people date to get somewhere, which is really messy. And so it's a hard town. And I said, I'm like, he was right down there. Right there in the sharing the laundry machines or whatever.
That's funny.
So, yes.
Now, the last time you were on the show, you had mentioned that you were a virgin. And I kind of half took that as a joke, but then I thought, wait a minute. No, I think she probably is. So I've had some people like, is she a virgin or was that a joke? Or is she like, you know, what's going on? She said she had a boyfriend, so.
Well, we just need to keep them guessing.
Okay.
How do you define virgin?
Well, that's what I was going to ask you. Mm-hmm. I was going to ask you, what's your definition of a virgin since you proclaimed it and you have a boyfriend? We all like to know how that equates into the definition. Because if I was your boyfriend, you know, I think it would be, you know, I think it would be a cool amenity to, like, share in that intimacy. So,
you know, there was a man I dated before the man I'm dating now, and he was transitioning to become a woman. So he wasn't fully functioning, and then he had to cut off. But he's really not a woman. He's just someone without. So there are all kinds of ways to work around these things, and all right. kinds of ways of love.
That's true.
I like to keep people guessing.
All right.
It's way too boring, not.
We're gonna continue to guess.
Me, one day.
I am not a virgin, so you can check that off your list.
He's lying. Yeah. He's a good Christian boy, or whatever.
Oh, that's funny. Advice on, you know, since we're talking about how hard it is, you know, to date in Hollywood.
Right.
What kind of advice would you have for one, even pursuing your dream, mm-hmm. or trying to live the dream in Hollywood, and two, you know, actually dating or trying to find someone, or, you know, in a hard town. What are, like, you know, what are some of the white elephants in the room you would address on a date or dating in Hollywood?
Yes, dating in Hollywood is hard. The interesting thing is, in Los Angeles, there are so many different subgroups of people. And I've known a lot of people who hate LA, and I can see why. It's superficial and dirty. But then I love LA because there's a whole community that I'm tapped into of people who are Renaissance Fair people or hippies or former hippies. I call it the Hollywood hippie crowd. Or, you know, variety entertainers or clowns or circus people. So there's a lot of different worlds. I still think both with your success in your work and in relationship is it's an internal job. It wasn't until I did some real internal work on myself and cleared out emotional things, cleared out blocks and patterns. Then the people are there. They say when the student is ready, the guru comes. And so I think a lot of it is an inside job. And I don't mean stay home and sit there and do nothing. I mean doing a lot of whatever kind of therapy. And I'm not saying spend $200 for a shrink in Beverly Hills. I'm saying just your own internal work and seeing what you really need to let go of and what you want to bring in. It's a lot of work. And then on a practical level, for your job and career, is just follow your passion, do it, and find a way of doing it, because there are ways of doing it. And finding a way of monetizing it, but also letting go of the monetization sometimes when you know that there is not going to be monetization, you just have to do it anyway. But there are also ways of monetizing. I mean, I can't believe I monetized a career of, like, opera, German cabaret, and Celtic music. But there was a call for it in certain places, in certain communities. But I, you know, had a degree in it and was trained, so I trained hard. And as far as finding people, I'm very impressed with meetup groups. I first heard about the meetup group a few years ago only, and it was a meetup group a friend told me about for people with social anxiety. And I said, that is great that these people who have social anxiety are taking that step. The hardest thing for them is to go meet people. They know they're going to go meet another group, a whole group of people who also have that.
Hard time meeting people, yeah.
And I thought that was really neat. And I'm seeing there's so many different meetup groups for your interests. And then you're not meeting fishy people on the internet. You're meeting people with interests.
Yeah. Well, cool. That's really good advice. It's always a pleasure having you on.
Thank you. I love being on.
I could go on for, like, hours. I know you have a curfew. We're 3 minutes past your curfew, so we're going to call it quits for today. But thank you very much for coming on. How can we find you on the web? Give us all of your social media contacts and your, you know, your Instagrams and your Facebook and your website and
so all that. Easiest way is Google my name, which is Christina, C-H-R-I-S-T-I-N-A, Linhart, L-I-N-H-A-R-D-T. My website is circussanctuary.com. Circussanctuary.com. And then I have a YouTube page with a lot of videos. So either my name or circussanctuary.com. And my second album is Voodoo Princess. You can try Googling those.
Awesome. Well, I want to have you back. I mean, you can come back anytime you want to. I'm going to be here. So, you know, please squeeze us in.
Absolutely.
And if you want to come back, bring some friends or some talent some interesting people of like minds or like groups. I have plenty of microphones, so
that's right,
we
that's
can
right.
you know, we can make sure we can get everybody on, and they can share some of their opinions and whatnot. I'm the Pod Brother. This is the Hollywood Boulevard podcast, and you guys have been so much fun. Thank you for your time and for your data and for all your feedback, and I really enjoy sharing a moment with you. And I also want to thank the Pig and Whistle, and Christina McCoury will be back from
The Big Easy.
Yeah. So we'll have her back. We miss her terribly.
Yeah, I can imagine.
She's such a cutie. So thank you very much. You can catch me at podbrother.com, Podbrother Nation, and stick with the podbrother.com. I'm also launching a new sports podcast called The Ram Ones, because we now have the new NFL team, the Los Angeles Rams. Well, they're not new, but they're returning. And I'm pretty excited to see what's going to happen with the Rams in Los Angeles with the NFL, because I am, you know, a sports guy. So you can catch me there at ram-ones.com, and we're just going to have some comedic dialogue about any and everything Rams and NFL. So thanks a lot, guys. We will check you on the flip-flop.
Bye-bye.
See you, baby.
See ya.
My naked clown.
That's right.